Spring Hilltop. Thank you so much for tuning in this morning to our live stream. We're just so glad that you're here with us this morning. We're going to worship the Lord. We're going to invite the Holy Spirit to come into right where we are right now and move as only He can move in our lives. Here we go. Let's go.
Come, let us sing out this song of praise.
Let our hearts rejoice.
Let our hearts rejoice, for you are great.
Nothing in this world compares to you, Lord.
Nothing in this world compares to you.
Because, Lord, you are our hope.
Because our hope is found only in you. Holy Spirit, you are welcome in this place.
Setting us free this morning, because I'm a child of God. Amen.
That's right.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but He brought me in. Oh, His love for me. Oh, His love for me. Who the I'm a child of God, yes I am.
Free at last, He has
child of God. Yes, I am. Yes, God, we just worship you this morning because you're a way maker, God. You're a miracle worker. You're a promise keeper, and there's no one like you, Jesus. We just praise your mighty name. We sing out, you are here. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. And you are here. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. Healing every heart. You are here. Healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you. We sing Waymaker. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. One more time, we sing it out. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. And you are here. You are here, turning lives around. And I worship you. I worship you. You are here. promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. One last time, church. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Oh, we just praise your mighty name, King Jesus. Thank you, Father, for never breaking a promise, Lord, for being a miracle worker, for being the light in the darkness, God. Thank you for being who you are. We praise your mighty name, King Jesus. We worship you, Father God, through any circumstance, through any season, Lord. We magnify your glory, your glorious name, God Almighty. We praise you, Father. We worship you. We love you. We love you, God Almighty. We love you, God Almighty. Thank you, Jesus.
Hilltop, thanks for joining us today. I've got a few things I'd like to share with you. If you're watching on Facebook, would you share this stream right now? Everyone can use some encouragement and hope. Want to stay current with all that's happening at Hilltop? If you visit our website, you can download our new Hilltop app. Think of it as a digital bulletin. With the app, you can see announcements, watch our online messages, and stay up to date with all that's going on. Do you know someone who is struggling to make ends meet and can use some food? Our food pantry ministry can help. If you or anyone you know is in need, have them stop by the church office Monday through Friday from 9 a.m. to noon to pick up a bag of food. If you'd like to make a donation, you can drop by your dry or canned goods off at the church office during the same time frame, Monday through Friday, 9 a.m. to noon. Interested in helping our local school kids? Our Hilltop Cares Ministry is looking for composition notebooks, dry erase markers, and 9x12 dry erase whiteboards. Local children doing their best to learn online can really use these supplies. Just drop them off at the church office between 9 a.m. and noon, Monday through Friday. Let's help families in need. Hey, parents, are you ready to get out and have some social distance fun? Pastor Matt and Hannah will be at Fernandez Park this Thursday from 5:30 to 7 p.m. with our young adults, junior high, and high school students just to hang out. Masks are encouraged and all social distancing guidelines will be in place. Hope to see you this Thursday. Hilltop ladies, join us for the Sweet Life Experience virtual conference September 26th from 9 a.m. to 12:30 p.m. And remember, it's free! Just register at ncnwomen.org. Do you miss seeing your Hilltop friends and family? Join us online today, immediately following this service in our Hilltop online lobby. Click the Zoom link on our Facebook or YouTube chat to see and say hi to everyone you've missed over the last few months. One of the ministries Hilltop supports is Teen Challenge. Teen Challenge is an incredibly effective ministry that brings the freedom of Christ to drug and alcohol dependent men and women. This year, to provide an update on their ministry and to raise yearly support, Teen Challenge is hosting an online gala. To participate or find out more information, visit us at hilltopcommunitychurch.com. Hilltop family, mark your calendars! On September 26th, we are joining a global simulcast called The Return. This is a national and global day of prayer and repentance that churches all around the world are participating in. Church, we need to pray. We will give you more information as the day approaches, but for now, mark your calendars for Saturday, September 26th. We will show you a short video clip in just a moment. And again, thanks for joining us this morning. We'll see you next week.
Is this a wake-up call? Is God trying to reach us, warn us, call us back? The time to pray, to seek His face, may never come again. If we do not return now, we may pass the point of no return. God is calling. return to me, and I will return to you. I will restore you and heal your land. The time is late. The return, a global day of repentance and prayer. It is time to return.
Good morning, Hilltop, and what a joy it is to be able to be back with you after a week away. I want to give a special thanks to Pastor Matt for giving us the opportunity to be away. What a great message on encouragement that Pastor Matt brought to the church. We're so proud of my son and his wife, and both my sons. I'm so very proud of them. But my wife and I, while we were away, we were up at Squaw Valley in Tahoe. It was scheduled to be the Northern California and Nevada Minister's Retreat, but at the last moment, the Squaw Valley Resort was not able to accommodate for our gatherings, our 400 ministers up there where we'd have our meeting times and inspiration, but they were generous enough to allow us to still use the rooms, and so we had a lot of free time, got to drive around the lake, and just a wonderful time of relaxation. I hope that you will have those opportunities or have had those opportunities this past a few weeks or even the days ahead. But it's really glad to be back here today. We're going to be starting a brand new series that I'm calling Thriving in Climates, in the Climates of Life. And we're going to look at that in just a moment. But before we do that, if we were gathered in our services and our sanctuary, and again, this is what we hope to do one day soon, is be able to gather together. But and this would be our normal time in which we would receive the Lord's tithes and offerings. And again, you have many ways in which you can give. This is an opportunity for you to trust in God. The Bible says that we're to trust in Him with all of our heart and lean on our own understanding. In many ways, it doesn't seem to make sense to give God the first fruits and to watch how He takes 90%. How we can take the 90% remaining after we give our first 10% to God and make it go 110%. That's God, and He can do it, and I've seen it in my life, and I know those of you who've been faithful, you've discovered that as well. But you can give multiple ways. You can give through our website at www.hilltopcommunitychurch.com, and you can also give via text message. It's up on the screen right now. But you can also take and request a postage paid envelope. It looks like this. I think Pastor Matt showed you this list last week. It's postage paid. You can request it from our office and we'll send you however many you would like. And wherever you're at in the United States, you don't even have to be at your home. You can be anywhere in the United States if you travel anywhere, if you're allowed. And it'll come to us through postage paid already. And again, we're so grateful. We're so grateful for your continued giving and it enables us to continue. Recently received a notification from our national office in Springfield, Missouri, the General Council of the Assemblies of God, and they were so grateful. They congratulated you and I for being a generous church that even during this COVID time, that we actually have increased our giving to missions to be able to assist, as this is an unprecedented opportunity. And we've given you some of those understandings in regard to Project Rescue and Teen Challenge and others. I want to thank you for that. Now, we're going to pray, and I'm going to ask for God's blessing upon this time of giving. And I also want to encourage you that at the conclusion of this service, we're going to be receiving the Lord's Supper, where we're going to remember the Lord with communion. And so this will be an opportunity for you to prepare yourself with a cup for the fruit of the vine and bread, as this will be our opportunity to remember what Jesus did for us on the cross. We'll do that at the conclusion of this message. But let's pray for the time of giving here and for the message. Now, Father, again, we thank you for the opportunity that we have to invest in the kingdom of God. For Lord, there's nothing that we can give you that you didn't first give to us. So Lord, you don't need us or our gifts because you gave it to us first. But Lord, you look forward to the opportunity for us to be generous like you're generous. That as we are generous and loving to others that we may not even know, that we may not even meet this side of eternity, that Lord, you set into motion something miraculous. You set into motion the law of the harvest, in which the things that we sow, we reap, but we always reap more than we sow. I thank you for your generosity to us, Lord, for your word says that every good and perfect gift comes down from the Father of lights above. We're so grateful for that. And we're asking for your blessing upon this giving and upon also the time of word that we have to share. And we're asking these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, again, it's a joy to be able to come to you today, this Sunday, and bring God's word to you. And again, this week I'm beginning a new series called Climate Change, and we're doing this series on how to thrive in the climates of life, because that's what we all need to do. And we're going to be looking at different seasons in the few weeks ahead. You see, when God created the earth, he set up climates of weather. In Genesis 2:2, the Living Bible says, as long as the earth remains, there will be springtime and harvest, cold and heat, winter and summer, day and night. We all know that, don't we? God has established climates of human activity as well. Seasons of life, relational and physical, spiritual, emotional climates of life. Ecclesiastes 3:1, the New Century Version says, there is a time for everything and a season for every activity under heaven. As one translation says, everything on earth has its special season. During this COVID climate, I started gardening. My wife was feeling a little insecure with vegetables and stuff, and so she requested that I plant some vegetables, and I've done that. And I've discovered that I actually like to watch things grow. And I think every gardener knows that if you don't have changes in climate, your plants aren't going to make it. In fact, as we've had unprecedented heat in the last little days here, I have these cucumber plants that have been planted, and they're up on the deck, and I noticed that they had wilted, and I had just watered them the night before, and they were wilting. It was so hot in the daytime. So I actually had to put a shade over the top of them. And a couple hours later, boy, they perked right back up. But if there weren't any seasonal changes, then plants would not be able to grow. And the same is true in our lives. You have to go through various seasons and climates in order to mature and grow. And that is the point of it all. Today, I want to give you 5 general facts about the climates of life. And then we're going to look at how to make the most of the climates of life, regardless of which one you may be in right now, because you may be in a different climate than I am, even though we're all in the same COVID climate. And then we're going to look at individual seasons that we all go through. So let me give you 5 facts about climates. Number one, they are beyond my control. They're beyond your control as well. You can't control when they happen. You can't control how long they happen. You can't control the location or the duration of them. Most climate changes begin with an irritation or an interruption or an inconvenience. When you enter a new season, your neat little schedule gets thrown out the door. That's what's happened with COVID. All of a sudden, because of something that just happens in your life, all your plans evaporate and all you have to be all completely redirected. I think about other climates in our lives besides COVID. You see, grief is a climate, and it's a change in our lives. And we'll go through this many times in life, because there are many times when you have an extended illness that you can't control. There'll be times in life if you're a parent, your kids are eventually going to grow up and move out and marry, and that will be a loss. And every one of us, you know, every one of us watching right now are going to lose a loved one in our lifetime, and we can't control that. It's frustrating that we can't predict climate change in our life. But we can never figure out what we're going to be going through, or what's going to happen next. But we can see what the climates are we are in right now. You see, waiting is another climate change in life. Do you know the reason why you have to wait so much in life? It's because many things are out of your control. In fact, most things are. If you could control it, you wouldn't have to wait. And so climates are uncontrollable in our lives. No matter what you'd like to do about it, worry about it, it's not going to change the climate. Have you noticed that some seasons seem to speed by others, while others seem to drag out? I remember when I was in elementary school, it just seemed like it took forever to get through the 6th grade. I could hardly wait to get to junior high, and it was like 6th grade lasted 3 years. Not really, but it just seemed like that way. It seemed to drag on, and school was never going to get out. Do you remember those clocks that they had in school? They had the hand that would take a half step back before it would spring forward, and then when it would spring forward and make this loud click. You know, those last minutes of the day, they just seemed like they would last forever and ever and ever. And then when I got into high school, that went by pretty fast. All of a sudden, boom, 4 years was over. You know, football was over. And then I had to go, then I was thinking about college and what I was going to do and all those things. And I've talked to you about those in times past, how God worked and all that and redirected me. But when I got to college, I thought I was going to die. I didn't know anything about the Bible. I went to Bible college, Bethany Bible College. I remember taking a Bible entry exam and I failed it. I didn't know anything. I thought I was going to be writing term papers for the rest of my life and reading hundreds of pages each and every day for the rest of my life. I couldn't believe that professors would think that they were the only class that you had when you had six or seven of them, and each one of them assigned 100 pages a day to read. I thought my life was just over. You know, now it's a little bit different. Now I read because I want to learn and I want to pass on things to you. But some things happen fast and some things happen slow. You can't control the duration of the climate that you're in. So who does determine the seasons and the climates? Well, I think you know where I'm going with this. God does. Daniel 2:21, today's English version, says this: God controls the times and the seasons. He makes and unmakes kings. He sets some people up as leaders. He deposes others. God is in control of the world events. It may not look like it, but He is. That's why, as your pastor, I don't worry too much about what's going on in the world. Some of you have gotten in touch with me and I've talked to you and you've been concerned about this or that and how the COVID started and who did it and is this the end times and all of this. And again, I want to say, yes, it is the end times. I don't know when Jesus is coming back. Could be today, could be tomorrow, could be next week or next year. But I do know that these are the end seasons. But God is ultimately in control. And He's moving this world to a destiny that He has in mind. I mean, whoever's in office in November, you know, all these things, the long and short of it all, it's not going to affect at all what God has planned for this world. Well, the second fact I want you to know is that seasons of life are often confusing. Sometimes you're in situations and you think, man, why is this happening to me? I don't understand this. Understanding usually follows an experience rather than precedes it. We tend to understand the climate we're in after they're over. We don't usually understand it while we're in the actual situations. We say things like, why is this going on? What's happening? We don't see any good in it many times. But looking back on our life, you have a far greater perspective than just looking ahead. Looking ahead, you don't know what's going to happen. Looking back, you know everything that's happened, and it gives you a perspective to see the climates, the seasons that you've gone through. So oftentimes there's confusion in this, but hindsight is 20/20. There are some things that are going to happen throughout your life that you're never going to understand. God doesn't owe you an explanation. You're not going to get an explanation until you get to heaven, because God wants to teach you to live by faith, not by explanations. The Christian lives by faith, not by explanations. Here's what Ecclesiastes 3:11 says, the New Century Version. God does everything just right and on time, but people can never completely understand what He's doing. Isn't that true? If you could understand why God does everything He does, you'd be God. And sorry to say, you're not. Your brain capacity isn't big enough to understand why God does all the things that He does. Which brings me to the third fact. God has a reason for every climate change in your life. The lonely seasons, the sad seasons, the seasons of success, the seasons of waiting, and the seasons of grief, and on and on and on. All these climates, and there is always a change in the climate. Romans 8:28 says, we know that all that happens to us is working for our good if we love God and are fitting into His plans. Did you notice the phrase where it says working for, and then it says the word if? This is a promise that's not for everybody. All things do not work together for good for everybody in the world. They only work together for good for those who love God and are fitting into His plans. In other words, you're trusting Him with what you're doing. This is one of the basic truths in the Bible. If you're a Christ follower, believer, nothing comes into your life that hasn't been filtered by your Heavenly Father. Your life is not a random series of freak accidents and occurrences and circumstances that just somehow happen. It's not by accident. God never does anything by accident. He has an appointed time for everything in your life, even the bad times. Yes, even the bad times. Now, don't misunderstand me. God does not plan all the problems in your life. He doesn't need to. You come up with them yourself. God doesn't have to plan bad times in your life because they happen because of what we do. We make bad decisions that we make and things that we do. That's why we spend so much time talking about choosing pathways recently, because we knew that if you learn the pathway and stay on the pathway, it'll bring wisdom to you and you'll find good things in your life. Bad things happen because there's sin in the world and because we're sinners. Sometimes problems happen because of a bad decision, not that we've made, but other people have made, and we're the innocent victim. But God doesn't have to plan bad. In fact, the Bible says He's not the author of evil, but He does have a purpose that He can draw good out of each and every event in your life. That means every single event, no matter how dark, no matter how shameful, no matter how bad, how guilty, how bitter I feel about it, God can bring good out of it. He can work for good. It doesn't say all things are good, because not all things are good in the world. There's a lot of bad. The Bible doesn't say that all things are good. It says all things work together for good. For those who give God all the pieces and say, God, will you work good out of this? If you don't do that, He's not going to work good out of it. But if you say, God, work good out of this experience in my life, He will. He has an appointed time for everything. Which brings me to the fourth fact. The climate changes of life include both good and bad times. Life is full of contrasts. We go through mountains and then we go through valleys. We go through successes and we go through failures. We have winnings and we have losses in our life. Ecclesiastes 3, 2 and 8 says, and there are 28 different life experiences there. And again, this is not an exhaustive list. It's just a representation. In weather, there are four seasons, but in your life, there are dozens and dozens of different climates that you find yourself in. But Ecclesiastes says this, and these are familiar words. If you've ever been to a funeral or even on TV, you'll find these things, that there's a time to be born and a time to die, a time to laugh and a time to cry, a time to find and a time to lose. That one there is one of the most difficult experiences in life. Have you ever had a problem trying to figure out, should I hold on or let go? Do I hold on to this dream that isn't happening, or do I let go because maybe it isn't what I'm supposed to be doing anyway? Do I hold on to this relationship or do I let go of it? You know, one of the hard things for rescue teams is that they have to face this all the time. Do we keep on searching or do we give up on the search? This is a difficult time. The Bible says there's a time for both of those things, a finding and a losing. A time to keep and a time to throw away. This is a good verse for your garage. Maybe during the COVID, you decided to clean up some things in your home, go through things that you hadn't had the time to go through. My wife and I did that, clean up the garage, clean up the shed, all these things. But I've discovered that there are usually two kinds of people. There are hoarders, people who hold on to everything, and then the pitchers. And I'm not talking baseball here. I'm talking those who throw things away all the time. It seems pitchers always marry hoarders, and it creates enormous sparks of kind of creativity here, you know. Some of us are such hoarders, you not only fill your house with it, but you have to buy one of those little mini storage places and put more stuff in. I mean, honestly, we're a nation of hoarders. We gather, 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 and then there are others who are scattering, scatterer. Then it goes on, it says, a time to hug and a time not to hug. A time to speak up and a time to be quiet. Usually we get those two mixed up. We need the courage to speak up when we should and the love to be silent when we need to be silent. Life is a combination of contrasting climates and seasons. All sunshine and no rain makes a desert. If you're following God's will, if you're really trying to live your life according to the way God wants you to live, each of these experiences have meaning and purpose and value in your life, and they're all God's will. Some of you think that the only time you're in God's will is when you're listening to worship music or at church or having a quiet time or listening to a sermon. You can be in God's will cleaning out a closet. Did you know that? You can be in God's will mowing your lawn. You can be in God's will moving to a new location or not moving to a new location. There's a time and a season, a climate for everything. You remember Ray Stevens, he used to sing this song, "Everything is beautiful in its own way." He lied. It's not true. Everything is not beautiful. Cancer's not beautiful. Child abuse is not beautiful. War is not beautiful. Everything is not beautiful in its own way. What he did is he misquoted Ecclesiastes 3:11, which says God makes everything beautiful in its own time. That's very different. God can take even the bad things and in the proper season, in the right climate, turn them around and use them for good in the way that he intends. Only God can do that. Some of you are going through climate change right now that's not beautiful. In fact, it's ugly. Your finances look ugly. Your health looks ugly. Your relationship, your marriage, your friendship looks ugly. I heard a statistic that during the COVID crisis, that divorces have gone up over 25% because husbands and wives are stuck with each other and looking at each other and not having the distractions of other things in life. Maybe your future looks ugly. You don't know where your next job is or what you're going to do. But God will bring good out of it, and he can make something good out of it if you'll give him the pieces. Which brings me to number five fact. What I sow in one season or one climate, I will reap in another. Every farmer knows this. You plant in spring and you harvest wet in fall. You don't plant in spring and then immediately the next day you harvest. I mean, wouldn't that be wonderful? Plant a seed, boom, the next day you've got what you planted. We want to do that. I mean, it's like tithing. You put your gift in and God's going to respond the very next day. Sunday, you put your gift in. Monday, boom, there's a check in the mailbox or there's suddenly a huge blessing that's come knocked at your door. No, that doesn't happen. You plant a seed in one season and you always harvest in another. You see, growing up, I heard this. The bad habits you develop in the home and at school, you're going to carry on into your marriage and your career. Boy, that's true. Because what you develop early on, you keep going on. In times of pressure, you revert to form. You do what you've always done. That's why you want to create good habits. Why, again, we spent that time on pathways, being able to choose wisely, because you need to make wise choices. The way you respond right now is definitely going to affect your future. If you respond correctly in a season of life, and if you do the right thing, even when you don't feel like it, and there are times when you're spiritually dried up and you just don't feel like doing right, it pays great dividends if you do the right thing, even if you don't feel like it. It pays dividends in the future. The Bible says in Galatians 6:9, "Let us not be weary in doing well, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not." In other words, if we don't give up. Now, these are five facts about the climates and seasons of life. How can I make the most of each season of my life? How can I grow from it? How can I develop in it? How can I thrive in these climates? How can I become all God wants me to be? Regardless of which climate you're in, there are four questions that you need to ask yourself, no matter what situation you're in. Number one, you need to ask yourself this question: what can I learn in this climate of life? We talked about this in the last message in regard to the epilogue of choosing wisely pathways, because information without application is just merely entertainment. You need to always be looking for something you can learn in this climate of life. There are some things we only learn through experience. You can only learn them in the school of hard knocks. Deuteronomy 11:2 says, "Remember what you have learned about the Lord through your experiences with him." You see, to understand the climate changes of life you're going to go into, you've got to have one basic truth under your belt. Life is a test. Life is preparation for eternity. This is not all there is. You're in the warm-up act of your life right now. You see, you're going to live 60, 70, 80, 90, maybe 100 years, and then you're going to spend the rest of eternity in eternity. Far more of your life on that side of death than you will on this side of death. This is the warm-up act. This is a test. You're in preschool. This is the preparatory academy. God wants you to learn a whole bunch of things before you get over into eternity. And one of them is that he died for you and rose again for you, and he wants a relationship with you. After you have that relationship, he wants you to learn certain character qualities which you will take with you into eternity. You're only going to take two things with you into eternity, by the way. You've heard me say this before. Who you become, the kind of person you've made yourself to be with God's help, your character, and the people you have introduced to Jesus. That's all you're going to take. You're not going to take anything else with you when you die. God wants us to grow and to learn. In all these various climate changes, there's an important lesson to learn. To make the most of the climate changes in your life, you've got to extract those lessons. You've got to look for the truths, look for the principles. What does God want to teach me now? When you're going through climate change, you don't say, man, why is this happening to me? But rather you say, Lord, what do you want me to learn? You see, God never wastes a hurt, and he never wastes a season. He always wants you to learn something out of everything that's going on in your life. If you waste an experience, you're making a big mistake, because it's not just an experience, it's an education. You ask, what can I learn from this? You've got to use your mind. You've got to think and examine and extract and say, what does God want me to learn? Well, there are two facts about the school of experience in life. The first fact is this: if you flunk a test in the school of experience in life, you get to take it over. Some of you have been taking the same test 300 times, but you're going to learn it, and God will keep giving you tests. He'll keep giving you the same test. Are you learning to be patient? No? Well, God will put a lot of irritations around you until you learn to be patient. Why is this happening, you say? It's because he wants you to learn. The second fact is that just about the time you think you've graduated, you learn there are more classes to take. You're never going to stop learning as long as you're here on earth. There will always be more lessons to learn about God, about yourself, about other people, about the world, about the devil. God wants you to grow up to be like him. Notice it says, again, Deuteronomy 11:2 says, remember what you've learned. Again, notice that word remember. Those who forget the past tend to repeat those mistakes. The problem with the Israelites is that they kept forgetting over and over. They kept forgetting and they wouldn't remember the lessons they learned. So God says, hey, one more lap around the desert. And they did it for 40 years. You see, it wasn't just them getting out of Egypt. It was God getting Egypt out of them. You don't want to forget the lessons you've learned. Otherwise, you have to relearn them. The Bible says, remember what you've learned in your experiences with the Lord. So what does God want me to learn? Well, he wants you to learn a lot of things, but there's one overarching lesson he wants every one of you to learn in life. It's found in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 9. Phillips' translation says, this happened that we might learn to trust, not in ourselves, but in God. God will bring all kinds of experiences in your life to teach you to trust, not in yourself, but in God. Sometimes all the carpet is going to be pulled out from underneath you, and you're going to be flat on your back, and then you have to look up to God. Some of you have experienced that in the COVID crisis. You'll never know experientially that God is all you need until God is all you've got. There'll be times in your life when God is all you've got left and everything else has been taken from you. Then you will learn he's all you need. It's like the classic song of the church. I love this song. Some of you may not know this, but when I was an intern at this church back in, I think it was 1981 or so, and Pastor Chuck was leading a Bible study, an adult Bible study on Wednesday night, and they'd have a worship time up front, and he asked me to lead the worship for that Bible study. And I had never done that before in my whole entire life. And so I set about doing the task, and I got the hymnal. Remember the hymnals when we used to have hymnals? Those books in the pew racks and things of this nature. And I remember pulling out the hymnal, and I found this song called Solid Rock. And I'll never forget it. The verse goes like this: my hope is built on nothing less then Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. Remember the chorus? It goes, on Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. I love the verses there. There's another one that goes, His oath, His covenant, His blood support me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, He then is all my hope and stay. And the verse, the chorus goes again, On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. If my granddaughter Riley was here, she'd go, Yay, Papa. And well, she's not, but let me get these next 2 points going together here. First, number two is this, what can I enjoy in this climate of life? And the third point is right after, what is most important in this climate of life? You see, some people are always getting ready to be happy. They have this idea that when the job picks up or when the COVID is done, the business slows down, or when I finish this report or when I'm feeling better, that's when I'll be able to be happy. But the Bible says we're not to wait to enjoy life. We're supposed to enjoy it right now. Ecclesiastes 11 verse 8 says people ought to enjoy every day of their lives. You ought to enjoy every single day. The good ones, yes, the bad ones. Each one of them is a gift from God. Each day and each climate is a gift from God. 1 Thessalonians 5:18 says, Give thanks in all circumstances. That is God's will for you. We're to live the good and the bad days, the hard days and the easy days, with a sense of gratitude because each has been given to us by God. One of the most important concepts to learn in life is that time is life and life is short. James chapter 4, verse 14 says these words. It says, How do you know what is going to happen tomorrow? For the length of your lives is as uncertain as the morning fog. Now you see it, and soon it's gone. The Living Bible said that. The Bible compares our lives to the morning fog. How long does a fog hang in the air? Our lives are just this little puff of smoke. They're here for just a moment and then they're gone. One of the fallacies that we operate under is we'll say this, well, you know, I've got lots of time. You know, yeah, I missed that and I didn't get that, but hey, I'll be able to pick it up later. I got plenty of time to do that another time. I've got lots of time to build my marriage. I got lots of time to work on spending time with my husband or wife or my kids. I've got lots of time to memorize God's word. I've got years to work on making my life count. Well, that's a fallacy. The Bible says that rather than having lots of time, we have this little puff of smoke and it's gone. That means the sooner we learn what really counts in life, then the sooner we'll get on to what's really important. And we'll get on to enjoying it and making the most of that particular climate, that particular season. Another fallacy that most of us operate under is I can have it all and I can have it all right now. All the time, I can have it all. I can be it all. I can do it all right now. I can have a great family. I can have a great job. I can have a lot of money. I can have good health. I can look good. I can know God well. I can do it all right now. The truth is, I hate to bust your bubble, but you can't. There has to be choices. Ecclesiastes 3:1 says there's a time for everything and a season for everything under heaven. If that's true, that refutes the idea that you can't have it all at one time. You can't have it all at one time. You have to make some tough choices, some tough decisions about what really matters at this particular time in life. I remember when my sons were small, in fact, when they just were born pretty soon, pretty much after that, just before that, I used to do windsurfing. I used to take a windsurf board and go down to the Richmond Marina and windsurf in the bay or I'd go up to the Delta and windsurf there. And the problem with windsurfing is it's a solitary sport. You're out there doing it by yourself or with other people who are windsurfing, but you're not doing it with a bunch of people. It's pretty much you and nature. And it's wonderful. It's a great season, a great sport to be involved in. And it was exhausting. It really worked our body out, your upper body especially, and it was enjoyable. But when my sons came, I decided to sell that windsurf board. And the reason why I sold it is because something more important came. My sons came. Because I realized that I was going to only have them for a season. Ecclesiastes 5:15 says, live life then with a due sense of responsibility, not as those who do not know the meaning and purpose of life, but as those who do. Make the best use of your time despite the difficulties these days. We looked at that verse a couple times during the Pathway series because, again, it says with responsibility. The way that works itself out in my life, deciding what's important at this season of my life, knowing I can't have it all today, that's how it works out. I've got to make some choices. Maybe in this climate I can have this, but in that climate I can't have that. But for this present climate, I know what's important. Like, for example, right now, I know that Mondays, though there are many things I could be doing with my day off, I choose to spend it with my grandchildren, watching my grandchildren, watching them grow, teaching them things, loving on them. You know, my sons are now grown. They're now married with children of their own, and I sometimes can't believe it's gone by so fast. I mean, we used to take our boys with us just about everywhere we went. Why? It's because I knew very soon, one day soon, they would have their own lives apart from us. Just like the song Cats in the Cradle and the Silver Spoon, life has a way of waiting on no one. I have a bunch of pictures on my phone, and I have them backed up to the cloud, and I'm sure every one of us know about the cloud now. You know, it's out there on the internet, and you can store stuff to it, you know, all that other stuff, Zoom calls, everything else. But most days, my phone will bring up a picture that happened on that particular day sometime in the past. Now, when I was preparing this message, a picture of my grandbabies popped up. I could not believe, Riley and Sammy, that they were so small. They're nearly 2 years old now. And now we have another little one coming as Matt and Hannah are expecting another little girl. God is so good. Did I say that I was blessed? I have been blessed. God is true to his promises. You see, you can build a great career. You can build a fabulous business. You can build a huge bank account or a house or whatever. But if you lose your kids, you've lost it all. What does it matter if you lose your children? For me, at this stage in my life, knowing what's important involves some hard decisions, some hard choices, but it frees me to enjoy the moment. When you look at your life, you need to not only know what's important, once you decide, then you start enjoying the seasons and climates and the moments of your life. Now, again, I want to talk to you a little bit as it relates to parenting, because the Bible says that we are to enjoy the seasons and the moments of our life because it's unique, and I understand that there are parents out there that have teenagers and you just are about ready to kill them, or little kids trying to figure out how you're going to teach them things, and you know, new math and all these things, and the schooling is different because everybody's doing it at home in a lockdown state and everything, you know. But what we tend to do is we look back at the past and think one of two things. We say, well, it was so great back then. I wish that that part of my life was still present. I wish that these things were still going on in my life. Or we have a lot of regret because we know we made a lot of mistakes and we spend too much time worrying about it. Or we're looking into the future. You know, what's going to happen when this happens? What will happen to my child? What happens when I retire? What happens when my kids go off to college and I'm alone? And we worry, ignoring the fact that it's this moment that I'm to live in. Not what was or what might be, but what is right now. The Bible says, enjoy every day of your life. When my sons were small, we had them, Nate and Matt, we had them so close together, a year and a half apart, that there were times my wife and I were just utterly exhausted. And, I mean, it was an ordeal doing anything with them because there was so much, you know, it was like almost having twins. And I can't even imagine how people who have six tuplets, or, you know, all that stuff, I don't know how they do that, but they obviously don't do it by themselves. But Sister Dillingham was one of my wife and I's mentors, and she had been a missionary for over 30 years, her and her husband, Ovid Dillingham, Helen and Ovid Dillingham. And she told my wife and me to enjoy each stage because it would go away so quickly. Man, that was great advice. Little did I know how quick it would be gone. Nate was in preschool, and he came home one time with his with a piece of art that he made for his mom and I. And they had put his hand in some paint and he put it next to these words. And the words on the script said this: "Sometimes you get discouraged because I'm so small. I always leave my handprints on furniture and walls. But every day I'm growing, I'll be grown someday. Then all my little handprints will simply fade away." So here's a final handprint, just so that you can say, this is how my hand looked when I placed it here today. When my grandbabies are over, it's kind of hard to have both of them go down for a nap at the same time. So my wife and I have devised a system that we load them up in the car, in their little car seat, and we go for a drive. And after about an hour, they'll wake up and they'll be all cheery again because they've had a little recharge. And I like to reach back behind my seat and reach to hold their little hands. And I remember that poem, because they're so small, these little hands that are so busy doing stuff. You know, I compare the climates of parenting. And again, I think about when I had little babies. They're good and bad in every climate, every season. They're negatives and things that are really not all that fun. Limitations, you would say, in every season. When my kids were small, I didn't have any money hardly at all. We were just scraping by. But there are things in every season that are great and wonderful in parenting. And when I think about when my boys were small, I mean, with babies, you have to carry 50 pounds of paraphernalia with you wherever you go. You have to get a bigger car. I mean, I'd refuse. I didn't want a van. I didn't want a minivan. I thought, man, but we ended up getting a minivan. You know, there's so much to take with them, you know, and that's what goes along with having babies. That's a negative. The positive about having babies is that they have this smell that's so sweet. Well, except for when they have messy diapers, but they're so sweet. And when they hold you, and when you have toddlers, you're always picking things up. That's where the stage of Sammy and Riley are right now. They're attracted to this thing and pick it up and carry it around for a while and drop it wherever they happen to lose interest. And you have to find it and pick it up. You can't find the remote to the TV, you know, because they took it someplace. I mean, that's a negative, always having to watch them. But the positive is they crawl up in your lap and put those little faces next to you and go, "Papa, Papa." Oh, I love to hear them call my name. Or when my boys were small, and I'd see him crawl up on my wife's lap and ask questions. You know, why do dogs bark? What is green and who made God? And you read a story or watch a favorite kid movie for the 300th time as you're watching this little person develop. But you endure it because you know it's going to be gone so soon. And now even with school, and it's all changed. I mean, when my kids went to elementary school, they lied to us. They told us that we'd have freedom when the kids went off to school. I pray that that'll get back to where it's some kind of normal. But when kids get into school, they come to you at 8 o'clock in the morning. You have to leave at 8:10, and they say, "I gotta have brownies. I gotta have brownies. Where are the brownies?" And you say, "What brownies?" And they say, "Well, I need them for class. And I told you about it. And it's in my backpack." And they go through the backpack and there's a note from the teacher. And it's their turn to bring brownies. Elementary school for you is not freedom. But don't hold out for something other, because live in the moment. In those elementary school years, they're learning and developing and becoming little people. And even now, when you're doing school online, you get to watch them and be with them, even in their frustrations. They may not know how to log on to a Zoom call, and you're frustrated by it and all these other things. Don't get caught up in that. Remember, this is a season. And when my sons went to junior high and later on to high school, boy, I talk about a roller coaster ride, a mad, mad roller coaster ride. Emotions up and down, highs and lows, and you're going nuts trying to hang on to them. That's the negative of it all. Trying to stay up with what's going on in this world today, trying to keep up, watching them as they talk to you, saying, "Well, I don't think that's right." And you're like, you're convinced that they're brain damaged or something. You say, "Where did you ever get such an idea?" And they thought that idea was perfectly reasonable, and you're just looking at them wondering how they could ever come up with such a conclusion. again, you get to have input into the life of a human being, and you watch them forming decisions and making decisions for their lives. The point is this, Philippians 4:11 says, Paul said, I have learned to be content in any situation. This is the moment I'm living in. As a parent, this is a season that you're living in. There are limitations no matter what season you're in. It's just not parenting, it's whatever season. There are limitations. There are things you cannot do in the season of life that you're in. There, and then those seasons are gone. But there are opportunities and joys that are there that are also not in any other climate. If you're a wise person, you'll begin to enjoy the moments. Chuck Swindoll gives the illustration of an old nursery rhyme. It says, Pussycat, Pussycat, where have you been? And the pussycat says, I've been to London to visit the Queen. Pussycat, Pussycat, what did you there? Well, I chased a little mouse under her chair, he says. Stupid cat. He could have been seen Big Ben, Windsor Castle, the Thames River, eating scones and tea. You chased a mouse? You could have done that at home. You see, live this moment. Live in the season you're in where God has put you. Enjoy the moment of the season. To make the most of them, you've got to ask, what can I learn? What can I enjoy? What is the most important? So let me close with the last question you need to ask yourself in every season. How can I help others in this climate of life? That's the last question. What good can I do during this climate? The Bible says very clearly that you weren't put on this earth just to live for yourself. We've looked at this verse many times. Ephesians 2:10 says, it is God himself who has made us what we are and given us new lives from Christ Jesus. And long ages ago, he planned that we should spend those lives in helping others. God gave you abilities, talents, and energy to help other people. He didn't put you on this earth just to be selfish, clawed. He wants you to help others. You see, a lot of us plan on doing that, whatever that is, when things settle down, helping others, that. I'm gonna get involved when COVID's done in the church and we're gonna do some things. I'm gonna get involved and I'm gonna when things settle down, I'm gonna start helping in a charity. I'm gonna help other people. Let me just tell you this, they're not gonna settle down because this is called life, L-I-F-E, life. You live in the Bay Area. Be realistic, they're not going to settle down, never. There will always be something to fill your schedule. So are you doing what you were made to do now? Are you spending all your time, all your energy, all your efforts on yourself? In every climate of life, you have unique opportunities to help others in that season that you'll never have again. If you miss it, when that season's over, you'll never be able to help people in that way again because you're not in that season anymore. Proverbs 3:27, New Century Version says, whenever you're able, do good to people who need help. Notice it says, whenever. In other words, do what you can while you can and stop waiting for perfect circumstances. Well, people say, well, one of these days I'm gonna buy my wife some roses. One of these days I'm gonna write that note of thanks to that person who helped me out. Well, one of these days I'm gonna make that phone call. One of these days. Let me just say this. When I die, don't send any flowers to my funeral. I won't appreciate them. Send them now. No, better yet, send a frappe mocha from McDonald's. My wife would hate that, but those are great, by the way. Do good when you can. That's the point here. People say one of these days, someday I'm going to get involved in church. No, you're not. If you're not willing to do it today, there will always be something saying you don't have time. You don't have energy. You don't have effort. It's like some guy said to pastor one time, when I die, I'm going to give all I have to the church. The pastor says, well, why don't you give it now? And then he says, do your giving while you're living. Then you'll be knowing where it's going. Good advice. Yeah, you should put the church in your will. That's great. But give it now and you'll get the joy of seeing what happened to it and how it's blessed people and reached them and helped them to grow. There's no better time now than to serve, no better time than now to serve the Lord and to serve other people. Most people are miserable in life because of two reasons. They spend all their time regretting the past and all their time worrying about the future, so they spend the present procrastinating today, and they never get anything done. They never get anything done. Let me give you the secret of happiness. I've discovered this. It was taught to me by others. The secret of happiness is service. The secret of happiness is giving your life away and serving God and others because you are wired by God to do that. If you live for yourself, you'll never be happy. But if you live to give your life away in service or ministry and helping others, that's where the joy comes from. Jesus said, you lose your life to find it. People talk about the good life. The good life is a life that consists of doing good. Ephesians 11:4, Living Bible says, if you wait for perfect conditions, not Ephesians, but Ecclesiastes, if you wait for perfect conditions, you'll never get anything done. God wants to use the COVID climate you're in right now to help other people. What is it that you know would be a good thing to do, or it's the right thing to do? It would help you grow and it would help other people, but you keep putting it off. What is it? Something you keep procrastinating. It's something you know what it is because God's stirring your heart in regard to it. Let me give you a little bit of homework. Do something good this week. Something completely, totally altruistic. Do it for somebody else. And maybe they won't even know about it. Maybe just do it in secret. Do something good for somebody else, something totally unselfish. Do those things and watch what God does in your life. What a man sows is what he reaps. Stop waiting for things to get better. Life must be lived right now. It's the only day you're guaranteed of. You're not guaranteed of tomorrow. Whatever you're going to get about doing in life, get on it today. Get started. So the question remains, how serious are you about growing spiritually, thriving in the climates of life? If you really want to grow and become all that God wants you to be, then you need to start at taking advantage of the COVID climate you're right in now and start looking for lessons to learn, experiences to enjoy, things to be grateful for, priorities that need to be set in this particular season that may be different than in any other season, people that you can do good to, ministries you can have in this very moment, and ways that you can trust God right now. Don't let a moment go by. Would you learn to trust God in this climate that you're in right now, whatever that climate may be? Because God wants to teach you something. I'd like for you to bow your heads with me as we go to the Lord in prayer here today. And if you have never asked Christ to forgive you of your sin, if you've been grappling with this and maybe you've been trying to get on the self-improvement plan, you know, I'm going to try harder, I'm going to turn over a new leaf, I'm going to tell you right now, declare bankruptcy. Throw your hands up in the air because you know that you can't fix yourself. You're broken. You can't fix yourself. But Jesus can fix you. You see, I say this all the time, but why don't you admit what I know about you and what everybody else knows about you, and we may not even know your name. Why don't you admit that? You know this most about yourself is that you're flawed. You're deeply flawed. You're imperfect. You'd want to do good things, but you end up doing bad things. You want to be altruistic and giving, but you end up being selfish. The only way that can change is if you let somebody else take the lead in your life. You can't be that person. You've got to give leadership to Jesus. Ask Him to forgive you of your sin. Ask Him to put a new heart in you. Ask Him to change you and transform you, to take you to new heights, to grow you up in Him. The Bible says that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Will you just ask Him? Will you say, Jesus, I admit that I cannot fix myself. I admit that I'm deeply flawed. Will you fix me? Will you forgive me? Will you put your Spirit in me? Help me to know you and grow to be like you. Give me the preparation I need for eternity. Let me find hope and life, and to give it away to others. You pray a prayer like that, and Jesus answers that prayer always. All you have to do is ask. And maybe you've been a Christian for a number of years. Maybe you've gone stale or gone just fallen away a little bit. Right now, you can reassert that relationship with Jesus by asking Him. Get about doing the things that you once did. Prayer, reading your Bible, making Jesus a conversation an ongoing conversation in your life, throughout your life, throughout your day. Have a conversation with them. The other day I was on the trampoline with my granddaughter, and my wife and I were just both on the trampoline, and as I've told you, God has blessed us so greatly, and He blesses all of us. Everyone who puts Him first, God continues to bless. And we were on the trampoline, and little Sammy was underneath me. I was tickling him, and Riley was standing there next to me. I was reaching out to tickle her, and I just pulled my head up. My wife was sitting right there, and I said, "Jesus, thank you so much for our grandbabies." And my little granddaughter stopped. She put her hands like this, and she closed her eyes, one eye like this and one eye closed, and she was waiting for me. And I said, "Amen." And she goes, "Amen." My heart just wanted to burst within me, because these are the good things that God brings. But a conversation with God throughout the day, that's how you reestablish that relationship with Him. Would you do that today? I'm going to pray for you, all of you today. And for those of you who have special needs, God has made us aware of those things, and through email and calls to the church, and we're going to pray for the needs of the church for you too, right where you're at. But in just a moment, we're going to receive the Lord's Supper as well. We're going to remind ourselves of what Jesus did for us through His death on the cross. And so let me pray for you, and then we'll come right back with the elements of the bread and the wine. Let's pray. Now, Father, we thank You for Your kindnesses, and I'm asking for my friends here today, some who have been enormously frustrated by the season, the climate that they're in right now. This COVID climate has just given them just angst. And Lord, there may have been some cross words spoken to loved ones and things of this nature, but I pray, Lord, that You'd bring a spirit of forgiveness, a spirit of reconciliation. I pray, Father, that You would bring transformation of heart to everyone who calls on Your name today, that they would just simply admit, saying, "Jesus, forgive me of my sin. Jesus, transform my heart. Help me to follow You. Help me to make You known." And for those that have done that a long time ago and it's become stale or stagnant, Lord, let them reassert those practices that they once did, where they had ongoing conversations with You and reading Your word in prayer. Oh God, I'm asking in the name of Jesus that You touch them. And Lord, I pray especially for those that have made requests of us to pray for them. Lord, You know their names. You know the circumstances, Lord, for that one who's been struggling with COVID. Father, in the name of Jesus, would You bring healing? Lord, would You turn the tide and bring them back from the brink? I pray in Jesus' name. For those, Lord, who've recently gone through surgery, I thank You, Father, for successful surgery. I pray in the name of Jesus that You would bring the complete healing. For Lord, we know that when the doctors have done what they can do, that Lord, You're the one who knits the tissue together. And Lord, where there is puzzlement about what to do, I pray that You bring enlightenment to those physicians, to those nurses, that they would understand how to treat those who need help today. Lord, I pray for our country, that You would, especially in these days and times where there's such division and such chaos going on, Father, in the name of Jesus, would You let those who stand for righteousness be like shining stars in the darkness, that we would know who they are. We pray for those in leadership, Father. We're asking in the name of Jesus that You would guide them. I pray, Father, for those who've suffered so greatly in this climate of fire season and burning down of homes and these things, Lord. Even as we've woken up this past week and seen the skies are dark, Lord, I thank You that, God, You are the master of climate. You're the master. And so we're trusting in You, Father, that You'll work all these things for good for those who are called according to Your purposes that agree with You. And so, Father, we ask all these things in the most powerful and wonderful name, the only name given among men that we must be saved by, the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Now, as you have gathered your cup and of the fruit of the vine and the bread, again, I want to reflect upon what has taken place, why we have this occasion, why there are nearly 2 billion followers of Christ in the world today that celebrate this occasion, this ordinance of the church called communion, or the Last Supper, the Lord's Supper. It's because this cup and this bread is the only thing that gives us hope. It gives us hope. Without this blood, this cup that represents his blood, and without this bread that represents his broken body, we would not have any hope, not only for this life, but for eternity. But Jesus was the Lamb that was slain from the foundations of the world. When John the Baptist was about ready to baptize, he was baptizing a bunch of people, and Jesus came to be baptized by John the Baptist. And John the Baptist knew, because the Holy Spirit revealed it to him, he saw Jesus coming, and he said, "Behold, the Lamb of God, which takes away the sin of the world." And every Jew in that crowd knew those words were familiar, because they all reflected upon the Passover feast that Moses had instructed them when they were in Egypt, that they were to take a spotless lamb and that they were to slaughter it and to place his blood upon the doorposts of the home, and that when the death angel came, that last plague, that when he saw the blood, he would pass over. This is why we do this. You see, it was on the Passover feast that Jesus had the Last Supper just before he was to be killed on that Good Friday. This is what we reflect upon. This is why we have this hope. This is why we can endure the climates of this life, because we know in all things God works together for good. Shall we pray for this cup and this bread as we partake together in just a moment? Now, Father, would you bless this bread? Let it be a reminder to us of the excruciatingly painful death you endured for us. Your word says, "For the joy that was set before you, you endured the cross, scorning its shame." But Lord, I know that it was not a joyful season in which you were in, for you died a horrible death. But you could see through that day to this day, and to the day when we all gather in heaven, the day of new beginnings. And that joy is great. Let our hearts be filled with that joy. Bless this bread and bless this cup. For your word says that without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sin. And I thank you, Lord, that you did not just love us partially, but you loved us with the full measure of your love, that your blood was completely shed for us. Thank you for that, Lord. I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Shall we break the bread and partake together in Jesus' name? In like manner, we take this cup. This cup again represents our Lord's blood. Jesus said that this was the new covenant in his blood. A new covenant because we broke the old covenant. But then he said that we are to take this until he comes. Again, I, like you, marvel at the things that we're seeing. This past week, the extreme heat and then the clouds, and it looked stormy and everything. The sun was blotted out, all these things. Could these be the last days? Absolutely. Am I looking forward to the day that Jesus comes back? Absolutely. I only have one concern, is I have some family, and you do too, that don't know Jesus yet, maybe some friends as well. My prayer is that they will taste and see that he's a good God, and that before it's too late, they'll have this awareness that Jesus came to give himself for them. Would you join me in prayer for our friends and our family, that they'll come to know him just before we receive this cup? Father, we pray for our friends and family. Lord, those that don't know you yet, would you allow them to taste and see? Would you call them, compel them, Father? Maybe through us or some other Christ follower, to taste and see that you're a good God. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Shall we partake of this cup in His name until He comes? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Would you just thank the Lord right now? Would you just, in your own way, maybe out loud or softly, your hands raised or quietly, in any way you feel comfortable, would you just express your appreciation to Him for what He has done and what He will do in your life? Lord, I am so grateful to You. I thank You for Your kindnesses, Lord. I thank You for my children. I thank You for my grandchildren. I thank You for my wife. I thank You for the adventure of Hilltop Community Church, which I've been a part of for most of my life. I pray, Father God, again, that You would help us to be bright light and strong salt in these dark days. Help us, Lord, not to become complainers and focused on what once was or what could be, but to focus on that today is a day that the Lord hath made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. I thank You, Father, for it. Thank You, Jesus. Now again, we're so thankful that You've chosen to be with us today, and I hope that you'll tune in next week as we'll be continuing on this new series called Thriving in the Climate Changes of Life, as we all will go through multiple changes, multiple climates, and we're seeing them even in physically now. But I pray that God will one day allow us to open up our sanctuary. We'll gather together. We'll be able to sing from our hearts with great gratitude. And that I think just we might just appreciate a little bit more that we can actually be together and worship the Lord together. God bless you. I'll be looking forward to having you with us. Join us next week again. We'll talk to you later. Bye-bye.